include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. We're here on quarantine with lots and lots of antelope about. Isn't that beautiful? You'll be able to see that it's very, well, you won't be able to see, but I'm telling you, it's very humid. It's very hot. You'll be able to see the wind blowing. All these antelope sticking around on quarantine. And that's because there's a storm brewing on Djuma Game Reserve in the Sabi Sands. So hop on board, everyone, for your live safari through the African bush. Hello, hello. It is humid indeed. There are so many big storm clouds all over the place. It's quite exciting, actually. And we're here on Djuma Game Reserve in the Sabi Sands. Like I said to you, my name is Trishala, and I have got Marcel on camera with me. It's about 30 degrees Celsius, 86 degrees Fahrenheit. So very hot, sticky, and heavy. And that could mean so much. At the moment, it's still too hot for predators. We've got lots and lots of antelope around. But as soon as those storm clouds roll in, and they already have started rolling in, as soon as they block out the sun properly, predators will start to awaken and prowl the roads. And that's going to be very, very, very exciting. Today, I am adamant on having some time at the hyena den. So I'm going to hang around in the general area. Check out the waterholes, treehouse dams, twin dams, and come back and check on the den every now and then. Now it still feels a little bit hot. I doubt that there'll be any action, but I am going to pop in just in case. And then we can go down to treehouse dam and the other water points. Maybe even just chill out there for a little bit, see what animals come over to drink and all of that. Like I said, your live safari, so please use that hashtag WildEarth or @FC on the YouTube chat stream. Or you can even go onto our website and register to use the question box, and we would love to have your questions and comments. The bush is almost quiet. It feels like there's something in the air. Maybe something special? I certainly think so. Well, I'm not the only guide of yours that is out here today. We've got Kim as well. So let's go over to Kim and her giraffe so they can say good afternoon.
Hello everybody, we've come out on drive this afternoon and found some giraffe, and they are doing something that we don't usually see giraffe doing, and they are sitting down. There's two of them. So welcome to andBeyond Phinda, and I'm Kim, and we've got Glenn behind camera with us today. We came out, we found these giraffes sitting down, which is quite unusual, especially for this time of day. Glenn's told me that this morning they actually found some giraffes sitting down as well. So it must be something about the weather today. It's relatively cool, so it's not something about the heat. It's not like they are very tired from the heat. It could be the wind. It's a little bit of a windy afternoon. You often will see giraffes sitting down at night time, kind of as the evening goes on, and they're getting ready to sleep for the night, but not really. I mean, it's 3:30. It's quite interesting to see them sitting down like this. They're not even chewing the cud. Sometimes you'll see them sitting chewing, but it looks like they really are just actually sitting and having a little rest. Yeah, David, these giraffes are really beautiful. You can see the one on the right. He's got those beautiful dark patterns and those big thick horns. So you can tell that it's a male because of the thick horns and that kind of bald patch on the top of the horns. And you can also see that his ears are tilted backwards. He's probably listening to me talking about how beautiful he is. He's even twitched his head to the side. But they do seem very, very relaxed. I mean, even in terms of awareness, there's not much looking around and ears twitching. Rosalind, I do not know how many bones giraffe have. I mean, I think that it's a similar number to what we have, in fact. I think the skeleton structure is quite similar to most mammals or most ungulates, but it is, they just have much bigger bones. There are actually quite a fair number of giraffe skeletons on the reserve. Maybe we'll come across one later on and we can go and have a little look. But I don't think that it's any number that's much bigger than what a normal ungulate would be. They have a fairly similar skeleton structure, obviously, except for that long neck, but it's just longer bones. It's quite a vulnerable way for a position for giraffe to be in, and that's why you don't generally see them sitting down so often. So it is quite interesting. You can see that they've chosen an open area so that they can kind of see around them a little bit. So that's one kind of line of defense, just being able to see around them quite well. But like I said, they're not even really looking around too much, mainly relying maybe on their ears. Estimated height of the giraffe when sitting. Jane, I would say, I mean, looking at it here, I would probably say maybe 3 meters. You can see up to its kind of shoulder, that male, maybe looks like about 1 meter, and then its neck probably like 2 more meters. So pretty tall. If I were to go and stand next to it, I still would only come up to quite far below its chin, I think. I mean, that's my estimation. But yeah, pretty tall, even when sitting. I'm quite interested though about like this, you know, I keep talking about the alertness of these giraffes and the awareness, but being in such a vulnerable position lying down like that, they really just seem so relaxed. Often when the wind is up like this, lots of animals like impala and wildebeest will be a little bit more agitated. They'll be looking around, they'll move around quite a lot, their ears will be twitching all the time, and they'll be making sure to keep all directions covered by, you know, all of their senses, their smell, their sight, and their hearing. And these two giraffes are just, I mean, that male giraffe is honestly not looked anywhere else except for when I was talking about how beautiful he was and kind of looked over at us briefly. But I mean, that's kind of as much as he's changed position. And even that female sitting so close to that bush there, I would think is quite a, well, not a very clever place to sit. But I'm sure they have their reasons. They do live out here and I do not, so. And there are some other ones as well. In fact, one's just walked out of that patch of trees that female's sitting behind. So maybe she's aware that the other giraffe are around her and they'd maybe alert her to the presence of a predator if there was one around. That one walking off, you can see is chewing on something. He's obviously been feeding from that thicket. Yeah. Reggie, there's only one species or subspecies of giraffe on Phinda. You get a different species up in the Mara. I'm going to have to brush up on my where the other species are, but on Phinda there's just the one species. The southern giraffe is the only one we get here. I wonder if these giraffes aren't going to just stay here for the evening now. I wonder if this isn't them settled in for a very early, for an early night. It's quite a beautiful scene though, with the clouds rolling in above the giraffe. Nice lush green background as well. It's all quite a pretty scene, and I've been away for about 3 weeks, so it's really, really, it's awesome taking all of this in. I think we're gonna leave these giraffes to their relaxation. I hope that they stay alert just keep out of danger. Maybe we'll go and find a giraffe skeleton to have a look at the bone structure. Or just see what else we come across for the rest of the afternoon.
I have just been to the hyena den that is inactive, but I didn't expect it to be very active at this time of day and in this heat. But I did say to you this morning that I know that the cubs are still there because I saw them yesterday evening. There was no adults, so we left. All five of them staring at me and wanting to play. Very, very sweet. So now we'll move on to our next portion, our plan B. And I used to go to the water holes. I'm still holding thumbs and hoping for elephants. And I really hope that I'll be able to find some. But it seems like even the whole morning, none of the vehicles saw elephants. Maybe we'll get lucky this afternoon. Some will come waltzing in, I hope. Tandi is also thought to have entered Djuma, cheetah cut line in the east. So we will scratch around there as well after we go visit Treehouse and Twin Dams. Anyway, let me send you back over to Kim and her giraffe that is very relaxed.
Well, I hope Trishala finds that leopard that she's looking around for. Over here, one of our giraffes has stood up. So they have not settled in for the night, as I previously said that they may have. He was obviously just having a little afternoon rest. Now it looks like he's probably going to try and get rid of a few ticks that he may have picked up while lying down there in the grass. Shame. Giraffe really, really do struggle with ticks on Phinda. You can see right up underneath his tail and also under his armpit where he's just been scratching. All those little black dots are ticks. And every so often you'll see the ox pecker, which will help them out with those. Jill, giraffe hearing is pretty good. Most animals in the bush have a very good sense of hearing, but I'd say giraffe have a good sense of hearing mainly because of their height, and I know that may sound a little bit odd, but if you think about it, they can stick their head up and out of trees, and then they can hear like above and beyond that. So, you know, if you think about when you like kind of go up onto a mound or whatever, or, well, I suppose that's also mainly for sight, but yeah, it just kind of helps them to capture sound around them a little bit better having that height. They also have quite good, oh, we've got a bit of action going here with the male. He looks like he might be quite keen to, maybe that's what's been going on here. Maybe that's a bit of an explanation for the resting that we've been seeing here. Because like I said earlier, it's a male and a female, and maybe he's been following her around relentlessly, hoping to mate with her. And maybe that's why they are so tired. Giraffe mating is an extremely long process. It goes on and on and on, and it takes loads of attempts by the male to actually kind of do what he needs to do and be successful in it. So I can imagine it's a pretty exhausting activity for both parties. The other giraffe that were here were all moving off in the direction that the female's now walking, so I think they have realized that they're getting left behind and are maybe going to try and catch up. But if they are mating, if that is what's happening here, that male definitely won't let the female get too far away from him. He'll stick around with her. No, oh, but he's not looking too interested. He's actually going to feed there. I think they're heading off to go and find those other ones that have moved off. I think if we move forward, they did all kind of head off towards this area ahead of us. We're maybe going to could catch up to them in front of us. Looks like I'm wrong in my prediction. Okay, we're going to carry on looking for these giraffe, and we'll send you over to Trishala and her hippos.
We've reached a treehouse dam. And we have this lovely hippo in it that's giving us quite a show. He's scent marked. He's also yawning widely. He's only ever by himself in this dam. Perhaps he'll find a companion once we get some good rain. And some cows feel like they want to find a nice bowl with a good patch of water. I think this is a good patch of water. There's some nice grass nearby. Look at it. Look at how beautiful it is. It's glistening with the sunlight. Now, of course, when you're with us, that's when our hippo decides that it doesn't want to show us just how big its mouth is. Maybe you heard the other vehicle coming and ducked down. Oh, there we go. Up again. Hello, handsome. The water level is getting lower and lower, I know. We need some good rain to rise it again. Cairo, you'd like to know how long they can live for? They can live for about 40 years, which is quite a long time. Very long indeed. Now, usually it's not the case. It's more like 30 to 35 because out in the wild there's so many things that can make you not live up to that potential age. Fighting for territory, drought, all those kinds of things. But they can live up to 40 years old. In captivity, that's probably a different number, though. The water is glistening beautifully. Look at that. Hiding from us. Oh, I love it when they turn their ears downward and then submerge. Looks like they're telling you where they're going. I'm going down now. Very cool. Come on, show us. Show us your teeth. He's usually very relaxed, this hippo. But today, as soon as we pulled up, he started to display. And when they display, they open their mouths up very wide, thrash around a little bit, and then, of course, spray their dung with their very soft, short tail. Bob, you'd like to know how long they can last out of water? Quite some time. In fact, they're days. But that means that they will damage their skin. But if the weather is right and it's very, very damp and rainy, they can persist for a long time out of water. In fact, hippos have moved, especially in the St. Lucia area in KZN, hippos have moved and walked over 1,000 kilometers from the estuary. Sometimes they've even gone into the sea, back into the estuary, and there's lots of adjoining estuaries along that coast if you keep on walking. And hippos have known to do that. And for them to travel over 1,000 kilometers will take days and days and days. Of course, they'll probably find a patch of water and go back in and come out and things like that. But they are water dependent in the sense that they have sensitive skin and adaptations that other animals have developed that would allow them to stop or prevent them from losing moisture. They didn't have to invest in those things because they chose an aquatic lifestyle. But those are not things that are detrimental to their survival. It's not as if they have gills and they need to breathe using their gills and taking oxygen from the water. So they're fine outside of water. It's just that they will not feel safe. Being outside of water for long periods mean that they'll have to increase their feeding capacity, because at the moment they don't eat the usual 5% of body weight that mammals do. They eat less, they eat about 3 to 3.5%, and that's because they expend a lot less energy being in the water. So they'll have to eat more, because now they'll be out of the water for several days. So there's a whole lot of things to consider, but it doesn't mean that they'll die just because they're out of the water for one day. Again, again hiding. Very cute. All right, well, we're going to head to our next waterhole now and stop for any little things along the way. But I think it was Tess. Or did I hear Kim? Somebody's got a sitting giraffe and you're going to go see it.
So, would you believe it? We've gone around the corner and found a bunch of giraffes sitting down again. So, there were actually six sitting down. Two have now stood. And while they were sitting down, we noticed that the one who's now rubbing his head against a tree was quite badly injured. And he's actually rubbing his injured ear up against the tree that you can see now. Yeah, his one ear is actually, you know, it's halved, I'll say. Half of it is missing. And before we could see, he had a very swollen eye. And I'm referring to him as a him because he is a male. Again, you can see from the horns. But yeah, it's fairly safe to assume that that is from a fight with another giraffe. I do not think that a lion leapt up and scratched his eye and ear. I think that he obviously had a skirmish I won't call it a skirmish, more an aggressive fight with another male giraffe, and his ear might have actually been kind of mashed off, like kind of hit so hard that it's just fallen off. I'm sure lots of people or lots of the viewers might know how giraffes fight, and they fight by swinging their necks and heads at one another, and they use their horns to aim their horns at each other's bellies and necks. And yeah, I think that's what happened to that poor guy over there. His eye is completely swollen shut, and he's got blood on his one horn. Shame, he's really not in a good way, and I think when he was lying down he kept shaking his head as well, like it's obviously really irritating him. And if it were, I mean, the reason I'm so certain that it's not a lion or a predator that has done that to him is because there aren't any other injuries on his body below his ear, so, you know, it just kind of makes sense that it wouldn't be anything else other than a fight. But I mean, sure, you know, can you even imagine the force or brutality that would have to go into creating an injury like that? I mean, his ears. Yeah. But it's... Phoenix, that's an interesting question, one that I haven't actually thought about before, but it's actually fairly common. I see giraffe with oozing eyes on a relatively regular basis. In fact, one of the ones that we came from just before this, I thought might have had a bit of a swollen eye, was another male. And it's probably from exactly this, fighting, you know, with one another, hitting each other with their heads. And as you can see, there's not much to protect their eyes, so they kind of have these blows. They hit each other so hard with their necks. They put like kind of all of their strength into catapulting their poor heads forward onto each other's flanks. And yeah, I think that that's probably, you can imagine like their eye getting bruised and then all that ooze and infection coming about. I'm gonna have a look at some of the others. It does look like a group of males. There's a young female there. But yeah, it's a group of males. Just looking to see if none of the others have any kind of injuries, because maybe the one who was fighting this guy is amongst the group. But it's possible that, in fact, it might have been that other male that we were with previously, who was with the female and who might have been mating. Maybe they were fighting over that female and this one came off second best, and that other one was victorious. Are we going to stay with these giraffe, I think, and see what their movements are. We'll send you over to Tess now.
Welcome to andBeyond Ngala this afternoon, everybody. I'm actually sitting here with a red-crested korhan. It's sitting on top of the Tomat Mound. You can just see its head. It's looked over at us. And I'm watching this male because he keeps making the sound that a red-crested korhan makes before they display. And it's absolutely an unbelievable display to see. It's called a rocket display. So I'm hoping we get to see him do it. So they spend quite a lot of their time on termite mounds because they eat ants and termites, and it's a good vantage point. My name is Tessa. I'm going to be your guide on safari this afternoon at andBeyond Ngala. Behind the camera, we have BK this afternoon. And actually, what we're looking for in this area is the pack of wild dogs. But you can see the korhan is actually coming down the termite mound now and going out of view behind it. You can hear a Stirling's wren warbler calling in the background. Sounds like a telephone ringing. And this korhan does an absolutely, it's a very unique display. It actually calls a very loud whistle over and over and over again. And then when it's done whistling, when it gets faster and faster, it flies straight up into the air, very high, very, very high, a good few meters up into the air. Folds its wings in and just plummets back down to the ground as though it's lost its consciousness. And then as it's about to hit the ground, it spreads its wings and lands very elegantly. But they're a very strange looking bird. It almost looks like a baby ostrich in form. It's got a very long neck, but very beautiful colors. And it's only the male that displays like that now in the mating season for females. So this bird, as well as the bird calling in the background, the Stirling's wren warbler, are both our star birds for andBeyond Ngala. Carla, I also love these birds. They are very unusual. But what we do at all of our andBeyond lodges, we choose 10 special or star birds for every lodge that's special to the region or to the reserve in particular. And this is actually one of them, this and the bird calling in the background, which is the Stirling's ring warbler, a tiny little bird right at the tops of trees. But I always love watching a red-crested korhan because they look so unusual. And the reason it's called red-crested korhan is actually quite unusual. They have this red crest that pops up at the back of their head only in the mating display. And I've only seen it once. I haven't seen it more than that. It's very unusual to see. And so everyone always asks, why on earth is it called a red-crested? Because the head is actually beige. But it's this crest that comes up at the back in the mating display that is that bright red color. Very unusual bird, but I do particularly enjoy them. So it seems to have gone behind the termite mound, and this is probably the termite mound within its territory. Senac, in terms of korhans, they can be divided into now korhans and busted. They have changed over. But in total, if you're including the bustards, let's have a look. Oh, it's calling. Listen, listen. And it stopped. It didn't do the display. That's all right. So we've got 8 species of bustard and korhan combined. If you're looking at only korhans, then there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. No, 6. And then you have the black-bellied bustard and the white-bellied bustard, which they were all previously called the same, but they have since changed names a few years ago. So I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to carry on towards the big clearings in the east, see if we can find the tracks of the wild dogs from this morning. I'm going to send you over to Taylor with her warthog.
Oh my goodness, I am so excited to show you what is disappearing behind the bush. And I'll tell you why I'm so excited is because that was Linda, my most favorite warthog in the entire world. and her two little piglets. My name is Taylor McCurdy, and on camera with me today is Sebastian, and we're here at Pridelands Conservancy, which is part of Baluli Game Reserve and the Greater Kruger. I'm going to go forward. Hopefully everything stays as I'm hoping, because to get a view... Sorry, the radio off. Okay, I'm going to stop here. Now, for those of you that have been watching this wonderful live safari for quite some time now, and you've been following us here at Pridelands, you'll know that I have become quite fond of a warthog who's missing her left ear, and she has been dubbed Linda. Now, I thought she had been eaten or died of something, because I haven't seen her for about a month and a half at least, and I was really, really, really worried about her. And she just appeared this afternoon, which was so cool. I almost jumped out of my seat, but I had to do so very quietly as to not scare the two little piglets that she has. Now, the reason why I'm also so excited to see her is that Linda is quite well habituated to not only the vehicles, but also with the sounds around camp. So the eco training camp is right here. And I thought that if she does have little piglets, which she does, she'd be quite relaxed and would afford us for quite a nice game viewing experience. And that's exactly it. She came right up to the car. It was so crazy. She must have only been about 5 or 6 meters away from us at one point. She quickly had a drink. The little piglets struggled as they went through all the divots, all the big footprints that the elephants have left behind in the mud, which was quite funny to watch. And now they're just kind of copying mom, trying to eat as much grass as possible. Aren't they absolutely adorable? Now, I don't know if she's just had these two, or if she did have more. But the chances of survival of these little piglets is not that great. Now, Brad, I haven't got a clue what happened to her ear. You'll see if she does turn around, we'll get a decent view of it. If not, I'm sure there's some wonderful people who will share some images on the social media. So it could have been that maybe she was involved in an altercation between a hyena, a wild dog, a leopard, or something like that, and they got hold of her. And she was able to escape, but unfortunately losing a part of her. Yeah, that's what I would imagine that had happened to her many, many years ago, because it doesn't look like a fresh injury at all. I don't think that it's affected her hearing too much. It seems to just be the outer part of the ear. Now, obviously, that outer section of the ear is very important, because when I put them up like that, you can see sort of little, quite concave. Wild dogs have got really good ears, almost like little satellite dishes, and they can pick up sounds quite easily. I mean, a warthog's eyesight and hearing is fine. Their best sense is their sense of smell. Oh, come on, little piggies. You can see that's a bit hot for them. They're just in the bushes. Sorry, we've just got a tree in front of us, but I don't want to move around too much now. But it is awesome just to get a glimpse. So I'm glad that we know that Linda is alive, and hopefully she'll go straight back to her old habits and visit Ndlovu Dam on a regular basis. Oh, it's a pity she's only got two. Like I said, I don't know if she only gave birth to two or if the others have maybe died. Oh, small enough to go right underneath the belly. But let's hope she keeps them safe. There's a lot of predator activity, particularly in the form of hyenas, around the eco-training camp. Now, James, so for warthogs can get exceptionally large. Now, the little one is tired. For a female warthog, I would say that they weigh anywhere between 60 and 70 kilograms, somewhere around there. Linda isn't a particularly massive warthog, so I would say she probably weighs closer to about 60 kilos, but they are quite big. But then the males are exceptional. They can weigh over about 80 kilograms. I remember once in the Eastern Cape, unfortunately there was a warthog that had to be shot. It had a broken leg, and it was in an area where there was no predators at all. So the most humane thing to do there was to actually just put it down. He was an old boar, and he weighed just over 100 kilograms. He was enormous. Now, where I live in the Hoedspruit Wildlife Estate, you wouldn't believe how big those warthogs get there. They are enormous, bigger than most of the pigs I've seen out here. So I reckon that those chaps weigh well over 80 kilograms. So they're big. They're not small. Not quite the size of a giant forest hog, which, if I'm not mistaken, can weigh over 120 to 150 kilograms, which is enormous. But they can definitely do a lot of damage. Oh, yeah, warthogs are an animal that are highly underestimated, but like in a place where there are lots of people living, warthogs become habituated fairly easily, mainly because of human error. You know, everyone that comes on holiday quite like to feed the pigs, but this can be very dangerous. I know I had a standoff with three boars not too long ago, and I kid you not, I jumped up on the table so quickly to get away from them. They weren't happy when I said, no, you can't have any food, because they've obviously been, you know, they beg and they get food, yes. As your dog would beg at home for scraps under the table, that's what these warthogs tend to do too. But they're armed with big tusks. She hasn't got particularly impressive tusks, the ones that you can see. The ones that you can't see, or you can just see a little bit, those smaller tusks on the bottom jaw, those are like steak knives. That's what I'm actually worried about. They're so sharp from rubbing up against on the top set of tusks that's really what's going to hurt you. Hello, little ones, trying to have a suckle, but mom won't stand still. Isn't this awesome? This is so cool to see the little impala lambs. I love this time of the year. I think most people like it. You see the tiny little warthogs. Mary Beth, yes, warthogs can live in a sounder where you can have a community of females and their offspring all living together. Every time we've really seen Linda, she hasn't been with any other sows. So that's what when we talk about warthogs being male and female, we talk about boars for the boys and sows for the girls. And then, of course, piglets for the babies, just in case. She was hanging around with two other males. One male was of substantial size and he had an injury for quite a long time, some of you may remember. And then there was another younger boar, which I wonder if it wasn't from her previous litter. But exciting times. I'm happy to see that my dear friend Linda is back and she has now got two little piglets in tow.
So we have got quite a beautiful set of clouds coming in with a storm expected this evening here at andBeyond Ngala. And we're sitting in a beautiful clearing watching the stunning clouds. Have a listen to all of the birds around as well, some woodland kingfishers. Absolutely stunning. Isn't it wonderful to just be able to sit and take in all of the sounds around us? The birds have been incredibly active today. I've been hearing sabota larks, rattling cisticolas. Absolutely stunning afternoon to take in the sounds.
Look at this perfect view. Hey, isn't this so awesome? Now, for those of you that have never been on a safari before, I cannot tell you how normally when you see a warthog with piglets, it is just a fleeting glimpse. They are, as you can imagine, like we see with the impala ewes, when they've just had their lambs, they're quite nervous, you know, they're very, very vulnerable. And warthogs make great mothers. They are so protective over their young. So I'm glad that Linda is back. I really, really am. And I'm so happy that she's still so relaxed after being gone for so long. I don't know where she went. And you can see those little ones are just having a bit of a drink. Now, those little piglets, they're going to grow up super quickly. They're going to suckle for the next 4 months or so. But like I said, as you can see, they're already starting to graze. They won't be taking too much of that grass into their diet. They're really going to be relying on mom's milk. I'm actually not sure of the quality of warthog milk. That's something I haven't researched before. Obviously, we talk about elephant milk and rhino milk and hyena milk. But I don't think I've ever discussed warthog milk. So that shall be jotted down in the notebook to find out some more information on that. Thank goodness for the interweb. Yes, little one, it's very exhausting. You've got to suckle. Now you're going to try and chew and put your bottom down on the ground. I don't think they've quite worked out how to maneuver as a mom is. And how efficient that is. Now, I'm not sure if it's Taylor, like my name. If so, your parents have got wonderful taste. Or if it's Kayla, either way. You're just 12 years old and you've been asked about the tusks of a warthog and what is the longest length that they have ever got. So the tusks that get the biggest are those big ones that curve up and back towards their face. Now, with the boars, I've seen it before where they curve all the way out and almost touch. I'm not exactly sure on the size, but if I just at a glance, it looks like almost the length of a ruler. I'd imagine if you straighten them out, I think it would be quite close to 30 centimeters or so. But maybe between the average size is about 10 to 20 centimeters. I'm, of course, just what we call busking. I'm just taking a chance. I actually don't know the answer, so if anybody does know the answer, you're welcome to share it with us. But they do get quite long. And remember, a lot of the tusk is you can't see, so there's still a section that goes back into the skull. And that's actually quite a fair amount. We'll see if we can't find a warthog skull somewhere and have a closer look, and then you can see how long the tusks actually do get. Hello, girl. There we go. Now you can see how she's missing her left ear now that she's turned around. You can see it's a very old injury, hey? It's not anything new, and I don't think she was born... I don't think it was a deformity, because it actually looks like it might have been from an injury. Hello, little ones. Oh, they're so precious. Also, tails swatting so quickly trying to get rid of those little flies, and they've been quite bad today. Although they should get some relief from all the biting insects because the cold weather is upon us and there's rain that's being forecasted for later this evening. Sure, I'm loving all the questions from the kids today. Denise, who's just 7 years old, has asked, how many piglets can one warthog have at a time? It's normally around 4 that they will have. They can't actually have as many little piglets as you know, the pigs that you're normally used to seeing can have, unfortunately. But so normally it's about 4 or so. But like I said, sadly, that they don't last for very long, which is quite sad. I did see one running around in Hoedspruit. Very funny. The safari hub of South Africa. It's an interesting town because you go into the shopping centers and you almost do a double take because you think, well, I didn't see a warthog. And there's 2 or 3 warthogs running down the road, stopping at the stop streets, looking. They're not looking left and right, but it's quite funny to think so. With all the little piglets in tow, that's actually where I first saw the piglets this year. Was not on the reserves, was just across the way in Hoedspruit, in one of the shopping centres, which was really, really quite awesome to see. But unfortunately, they've now run in that direction. I don't think I'm going to bother her anymore. I'm, like I said, happy that she's back, and hopefully she will keep coming back. So what we will do at some point, it's just a bit, signal's not so great, is we'll go around and we'll reposition at St. Lovu Dam, and then hopefully the elephants or the buffalo will do what they normally do and come down to the dam. Let's hope that they will do that. That's what we are thinking. Otherwise, another thing we could also look for this afternoon is maybe some giraffes. So I think we'll do some driving around too.
Welcome back to andBeyond Ngala, everybody. So I'm on the move again. I'm taking one of my favorite roads on the reserve, looking for the wild dogs from this morning. And I actually saw a hyena coming this way earlier. So that's actually why I decided to come and do this road. The last place that they were seen was just into the bushes on the left here. So I've been driving and looking for tracks as I go. Luckily, with a pack of 21 wild dogs, it is quite difficult to miss the tracks. So I've been driving along just checking. They haven't crossed the road behind me to the left, so I'm checking to see if they've crossed this road towards the Timbavati riverbed. It was actually quite warm over lunchtime today. The sun came out. And now that the clouds are rolling in again, I'm hoping the wild dogs are going to get a bit more active. This is also where they chased a leopard out of this bush on our left this morning. I don't know what it is with wild dogs and leopards the last 2 days, but we've all been quite lucky. You can see there's quite a bit of wind blowing. You can see the bushes blowing around me. And this is a good thing because it's cooling everybody down, but it also means the wild dogs are more likely to hunt. You'll actually see now as we get into the clearing, the sun is just starting to come out. It's got a beautiful silver edge to the clouds. So we've had quite an interesting day of weather. It was cold and overcast this morning, incredibly hot over lunchtime, so I'm sure these wild dogs must have gone to find some water. And now it's starting to cool again. So I'm going to keep going along here. Hopefully I manage to hear or see signs of the wild dogs, and I'll send you over to Kim at andBeyond Phinda with some rhinos.
We have come across some white rhinos, and as you can see, they are as interested in us as we are in them. They're all giving us quite a bit of their attention. Generally, white rhino are quite chilled, and I think that they maybe are paying us more attention than normal just because of the wind. Like I mentioned earlier, it is a bit windy here today on Phinda, and that does tend to make the animals feel a little bit insecure. Their senses are a little bit dulled, just like how it's difficult for you and I to hear when it's windy. That's the same goes for animals. Obviously, they just have a lot more to worry about. They rely on their hearing. Oh, isn't that beautiful? All lined up like that. They rely on their hearing a lot more than we do. They are kind of slowly coming towards us, though, so they're obviously happy that we aren't a threat. You notice how the little ones kind of keep or make sure that the big ones are always in between, in between them and us. The wind is literally blowing right from us onto them, so they can hear us very, very well, and they can probably smell us too. What a beautiful interaction. They really, really are just checking us out properly. Can see the couple of them, although one of the small ones has been rubbing himself up against a termite mound, one of those red clay ones. So interesting how you can see how they've got the older ones on the outsides and the younger ones on the inside. It is a fairly young group. I don't think that any of these rhinos are fully grown, and I don't think that even those youngsters belong to any of these older two. I think it's just a young group of rhinos who have banded together to keep each other company and keep each other safe. Those two youngsters are definitely old enough to have been weaned from their mother by now. It's possible that that far female, the one doing a wee at the moment, is the mother of one of these calves, which can only be the mother of one. And that other larger one is a male, so it's a young male. Quite an interesting little dynamic that they've got going here. And that's why I say I think it might just be a group of youngsters keeping each other company. Andre, yes, they do. Rhinos do make a few noises. They make snorting noises, especially when they are charging. So there'll be like a noise when, let's see, we even got a little bit of a look up. Maybe I shouldn't do that. When they are charging. Also calves, when they are kind of asking their mum for milk, they make this high-pitched little squealing noise, which is really cute to hear. And actually, if you don't know it's coming from a rhino, it's quite difficult to believe that that's where the noise is coming from. And yeah, I mean, there'll be some grunts as well sometimes when rhinos are fighting with one another. That's kind of about it. So we're going to stay with this little group, I think, and see what their movements are. They seem very interested in us, and I think that we're going to stick with them. But Tess has found some wild dogs, so I will send you over to her for now.
So as I left you earlier, I noticed the tracks of the wild dogs coming onto the road. And not 50 meters down the road, and BK pointed out the wild dog sleeping in the shade here. Absolutely sharp eyesight. And this is just part of the andBeyond Ngala pack. It's not the full pack, so the others we actually haven't seen yet. I think they're hiding somewhere in the shade because it is so hot. And you can see how these dogs are panting quite heavily, particularly the one with a darker side. It looks like it's eaten a bit more. So its body temperature is a little bit higher. So we're actually not far from the road at all. We're maybe 15 to 20 meters from the road. And I think this wild dog closest to us with lots of gold actually lifted its head as we came past, and BK managed to spot those big ears. Shame, you can see the flies are bothering them a bit. The ears are flicking. It's unbelievable to think there's actually 8 wild dogs underneath this little gory tree in that little patch of shade, and I can only see 5 fairly clearly. The other 3 are blending in so well in the grass just behind the gory tree. So I don't think it'll be too long before the wild dogs start getting active just now. Especially because it is starting to cool down quite a bit. The sun has just come out, but the bank of clouds coming in is massive. Jack, wild dogs will mate once a year in the breeding season. So they won't mate multiple times in a year unless maybe they lose some of their pups. So if they lose their entire litter, they might mate again. But they usually mate once a year, and then they'll be pregnant for around 3 months. So they actually should start mating fairly soon to give birth in May or June, but probably May, I would think. In that period of mating, the male will actually be very protective of the female, and he'll mate with her as often as he can in those few days when she's in estrus. It's actually very interesting because the females might try to align their estrus cycles, so they might try and mate at the same time, and that can cause a lot of unrest within the pack because the dominant or alpha female doesn't want other females to have pups unless they know they need to grow the pack very quickly. And so if that happens, that second female, that second female might actually get kicked out of the pack or have to abandon those pups. The pups might even be killed. But that's normally why the females would then move out of the pack and form new packs and find new males to mate with.
Where are you coming? Go ahead, bunny.
Oh, Barney, keep coming. You'll get our visual from the road. So I'm going to stay here and see what happens with them. They look like they are having a nice snooze, and hopefully they get up soon.
Join our Explorers program so we can keep on sharing nature with the world. For a monthly subscription, you will have the opportunity to win fantastic Wild Earth expeditions, have access to an animal identification app, receive weekly highlights from our shows, and much more. All the money will go to keeping these live safaris on air, which in turn connects a global population with nature.
My name is James Hendry, and I work here at Djuma Private Game Reserve in the Sabi Sands on the western fringes of the Greater Kruger National Park. My favorite part of getting questions from viewers is that we get to have long and varied discussions about all sorts of different aspects of nature. Because our audience comes from all over the world, it's very special to have different perspectives from everywhere. If you want to submit a question on Wild Earth, you need to register on our website. Once registered, go to the Live Safari page and submit your question beneath the live feed.
Welcome to my car. This is Wendy, and she's my favorite. She would love to have your name attached to her, so you can be with her every single time she goes on a safari here in Djuma. If you become a Wild Earth Explorer, you will have the opportunity to buy an engraved tag, which we will attach to her. We will make sure to send you a digital picture to show you exactly where you are sitting on her. You will have front row seat in every single sighting.
What makes andBeyond Phinda Private Game Reserve so special is our massive array of habitats. And with that comes, of course, a beautiful diversity of landscapes, but also an incredible biodiversity in terms of plants, bird life, and animal life, as well as, of course, our conservation success stories with cheetah, with rhinos, now with pangolins too.
Catch up with the guides daily here on Wild Earth.
So these wild dogs are still nice and sleepy here at andBeyond Ngala. You can just see the flicking of ears. That's the only movement you can actually catch with the eye. And that's just to try and get rid of those flies at the moment. But they are looking like one big tangle of wild dogs at the moment, almost like a puzzle. Can't even see a gap in between them, which is quite interesting because it is so hot today. You would think that on such a hot day, they would be a little bit more separated in the breeze. But they seem to be enjoying that contact. It's all part of social bonding. So it would actually be interesting to see where the rest of this pack is, because it's 21 in total. So we're missing quite a few, and it looks like all the pups that are missing. Warthog Queen, wild dogs on average in this area get to around 12 to 15 years old, depending. But oftentimes, because wild dogs are so endangered and because there are, you know, there are quite a lot of threats around for them, they might not even get to that age. But majority of them would get to around 12 to 15 years old, especially the females. We actually have a dominant male, or he was a dominant male of this pack, the one that we saw yesterday. I don't know if anyone was watching for that. Well, it's the same pack, but that sighting. The dominant male used to be the male that has the shorter tail, and he is incredibly old. He's been with the andBeyond Ngala pack for many, many years. He was a dominant male for at least 5 or 6 years, if not longer. And he's still with the pack. He just runs towards the back of the pack now. There's a new alpha pair. And I would think he's actually quite a bit older than 15. He's been incredibly lucky. I think these are actually just the adults of the pack. You kind of want to start thinking like a wild dog, thinking, where would you hide your pups if you were a wild dog? And there were so many of them. I would think they're actually somewhere very close by in a thicket. But it'll be very interesting because now that they're flat, they're still bonding, they're still awake, but they are resting. But as soon as one wild dog starts to wake up, it is absolute commotion and chaos. They all start to wake up. There's a lot of squeaking and playing that happens, reaffirming those bonds, reasserting dominance as well. The dominant pair will often go and greet each individual pack member or dog. And then they submit themselves to the dominance by licking the dominance on their mouths and often lying flat on their backs on the floor. So I'm going to stay here and definitely see what plays out for this afternoon as these storm clouds roll in. I'm going to send you over to Kim at andBeyond Phinda with her bird.
So you are probably now looking at a branch. And just seconds before you came to us, there was the most beautiful little African pygmy kingfisher sitting there. And that is a very colourful little kingfisher. And I suspect that he was hunting for insects. And I think that what has happened is that he obviously saw an insect or lizard and went off to to go and catch it. So unfortunately, I think we are going to have to move on from this area, because I think that he won't be coming back, unfortunately. We are gonna just carry on driving. I was planning on heading to a watering hole to see what we can see there when I saw this bright pink color out the corner of my eye, and we stopped to have a look at what it was and that to you.
So these wild dogs are all lifting their heads at the moment. There's a vehicle that's coming to join the sighting at the moment. And I believe there was actually a hyena just to the left of them as well. It's hiding in a little pan system at the moment, cooling off. And I think it might have been the hyena that I actually saw earlier. It was running this way, which made me do this road. And so I think it's settled knowing it knows where the wild dogs are now. And so now it's happy to go and relax in a little puddle and keep cool until the wild dogs start moving. But their bellies are so full, they've definitely had a lot to eat this morning, which is making them extra lazy. They're only waking up for movements. I should imagine though, if that hyena came in here, there would be quite a commotion. Wild dogs are particularly good at cornering hyenas into these guari trees where the main stems are. They corner the hyenas in there, and the hyenas just sit flat on their bums against the guari and make a huge noise because the wild dogs go straight for the rump when they're biting. They know it hurts. That wild dog that's closest to us is actually very beautiful. She's got lots of gold on her. She's a lot lighter than the others that I can see in that little mesh of wild dogs. And that gold color is really stunning, especially in the afternoon light. Jay, absolutely. Every wild dog has a unique coat pattern. No two wild dogs are the same. You will see some similar markings, so they can pass some, especially the white patches, the same sort of shape on to to their youngsters, but normally each one is very easy to distinguish from the others. It literally looks like a painter has taken paint and just thrown it all over them in different colors and splotches. That's why their other name is the Painted Wolf. And these coats really do help them camouflage. But it's always been one of my favorite things is looking for patterns in the coat of a wild dog. I remember in the monitoring program that I was working in, there was one that had a perfect fried egg on her shoulder in pattern. It was this white fried egg patch with a gold patch right in the middle. So she was very easy to tell apart from the others. So it's always fun to look for those patterns. I think my overall favorite pattern, though, is still that one from the Orpen breakaway pack with the pelvis marking on her pelvis, on her coat. Unbelievable. So the wild dogs that you find in this region in terms of their coat color are actually quite different to the wild dogs you might see in places like Botswana, because they have a lot more black in them. Ours have more white and gold in them. Jane, wild dogs will hunt usually every single day, twice a day. They are what we call crepuscular, which means they're active morning and evenings. And so they would hunt every day, twice a day. They've got a very fast metabolism. And with so many mouths to feed, can you imagine feeding your family of 21 every single day? It would be quite a tough task. So they've got to make sure that they kill enough. That being said, I have watched them make 4 impala kills in a row in the space of about 15 minutes before, and it was this exact pack. Because they have so many pups every single litter that there's always a lot of mouths to feed. I think the record for the amount of pups in a single litter actually was 19 pups in one litter. One poor female that gave birth to 19 pups. She was massive. You can imagine the size of her stomach. She looked like a bit like a tennis ball on toothpicks, maybe. With big ears as well. I think they're enjoying the breeze. It's picking up quite a bit. The sun has gone away. The storm clouds are coming in. So I definitely think they're going to start at least rolling over sometime soon. And repositioning. Oh, wow, look at the white on her chest. Oh, it's a him. Hello, boy. They've got such dramatic gold hair on the inside of those ears as well. Terry, wild dogs and most other animals can definitely be affected by ticks and tick-borne diseases. Tick bite fever is more of a human ailment, actually. So in animals, it's called biliary. And they definitely can get those kinds of diseases from ticks. So that's why they often groom each other. It's why they scratch and why they do want to be careful. I think what I'm actually going to do, so I might actually reposition a little bit. This wild dog is actually eating grass in front of us. So I'm going to pull a little bit forward for you and just hopefully we can see it nice and clearly. So this is actually a male that we know quite well. Now that he's up, I can see it. In his hip joint and the groin, you can see a raw patch on his side. He got injured when they were having a fight with some hyenas over a carcass not so long ago. And he doesn't look like he ate as much as the others this morning. His belly is not hanging like the others. It could be possible that he might even be feeling a bit nauseated. That's why he was eating grass. Now he looks like he might want to vomit. Yeah, he's gonna vomit. So the grass helps them bring it up. I wouldn't be surprised if he tries to eat it again. Seems to be the wild dog way. Almost looks like he's burying it with his nose. Right, so we're gonna sit here and watch what happens with this wild dog trying to bury what he's just brought up. I'll send you over to Trishala with her bird.
Here we have our red-crested corvine in its usual spot. Here on Philemon's cut line, and one close by just did the call that is usually an indication that they might do their suicide drop. So we're gonna sit and watch, see if we'll get lucky. You can do it, you can do it. I've seen lots of them suiciding recently. That sounds strange, but they do a mating ritual in which they fly up into the air and then drop down. Okay, there's one in the distance calling. I feel like he's taking just a very long pause before the big performance. Come on. So impressive. The first time you see it, it kind of looks like there's just a black plastic bag floating in the sky. I can hear the ones in the distance. And I love when it begins because there's a beak snap before the call. I think this one's a bit camera shy. Yes. Cold, but no display for us. Maybe it's just warming up. That was it clearing its throat. So cool. I hope that it will actually do it for us, but we can only hope. So they actually have arenas, or we call it an arena, when there's quite a few males all around, and then a female enters the arena, and then they do their display. So I can hear at least two other males, so I'm hoping that this one will do it too, and maybe there's a female around that'll watch. Very cool, don't you think? I think this is a good time to mention that there's exciting things going on here at WildEarth. So won't you pop over to our website, wildearth.tv/explorers, and learn everything about becoming a WildEarth explorer. Thank you.
I feel like this is a very poor place for them to fly up from, on this particular patch. But maybe it's a bit elevated, and we'll just have to wait and see. Jean, you'd like to know how long they incubate their eggs for? Their incubation period is about 22 days, and it's incubated by the female only. And their laying dates will be anything from now, or actually from like a month ago, until March, April. I've never seen a little red-crested corhound. I'd love to see one. I gave you the arena this time, red-crested corhound, and you didn't want to display for me. That's fine. Hopefully you will another time. But now I'm going to move on from you. Sorry about that, guys. I'm sure we'll get in Ngala soon. I'm still hearing the red-crested corhounds all over the place. Great timing, everyone. Also, it's starting to spit a little bit. It's starting to ring just a little bit. Well, let's have a listen. This guy and hope that he'll do it for us again. I feel like this red-crested corn is just wondering, what am I doing staring at it? I'm waiting for you, but it's fine. I'll move on now. About that, guys. At least we have this lovely impala to keep us busy until we get Tristan back. I can hear the rain falling. And the red-crested corn still going. Gosh, I need to get off this road, otherwise I'm never going to move off this road because I keep wanting to listen to them and hopefully see them suicide. Actually called rocketing, but sometimes, well, colloquially everyone says it's a suicide bird. Lonely male? What are you doing by yourself?
Nothing, just eating. I feel like I've come along this road and I'm just staring at all the animals and all the animals are staring back at me kind of thing, saying, what are you staring at? Why are you watching me? Because you're also curious and I'm curious about you all. I wonder if you can hear the very light rain falling. Probably not. I feel like it stopped as soon as I said, can you listen to the rain falling? Anyway, I need to move off this Philemon's cut line. Too many distractions. I want to go up to Zoe's. And I'm going to send you over to Tess and her wild dogs.
So you can see these stunning storm clouds rolling in at the moment. We've been hearing quite a lot of thunder sitting here at andBeyond Ngala with the pack of wild dogs. And it is cooling down incredibly fast. I don't think it's going to be very long before these wild dogs start getting active. The rest of the pack is actually hiding in the little drainage line in a little riverbed behind where we are sitting at the moment. They're very well hidden. So I'm gonna stay with these for a while and maybe the others will start getting active, especially the pups should get some more energy as these clouds keep rolling in. I don't know if you can hear the wind or not, but it is incredibly strong at the moment. You can actually see it on how those gory branches are blowing. It's actually fairly sheltered where the wild dogs are. But there's definitely quite a large storm coming in. You can actually smell the moisture in the air already. So it's very interesting. Wild dogs can be quite good at hunting when it's storming as well. Leopards, oh, thunder. Leopards actually do the same when it's storming. The other animals are at a disadvantage because they can't hear the wild dogs and leopards coming. So I'm hoping that they might get active and start hunting tonight. What I'm going to do, I'm going to stay with them as the storm rolls in. Hopefully they get active. I'll send you over to Tristan, who also has a pack of wild dogs.
Well, as we can see, we are waiting for the dogs to get active. And now that we've sorted out the fact that we can talk to you, well, helps a lot. The dogs are, for now, fast asleep. They obviously had a big morning this morning, chasing leopards around and feeding and all kinds of other things. But before we get into all of that, my name is Tristan. On camera, I've got Gert this afternoon. And it is lovely to have you all along for the ride. It's taken us a while to find the dogs. They were up in the ride in the northern part of Buffalo's Hook, which is in an area where it takes us a bit of time to get up here. We also got waylaid by multiple different leopard tracks on the way, but unfortunately all of them went into places where we just won't be able to get signal, so we left those. But it was tracks for Inklangula and Tlalamba, but not together, so separate places, both of them kind of heading northwards, which is interesting. But the dogs, like I said, they're resting for now. They had a really big morning. They were active until quite late this morning. They were still terrorizing in Sele until about 10:30 this morning. And then they eventually lay down in this area and are taking it easy. But what I suspect will happen is as this cooler weather is coming in, it seems like there's a bit of rain around, there's a bit of a breeze blowing. As it starts to get cooler, so the dogs are going to start standing up and moving. And I'm really intrigued to see where this pack goes from here, because generally the sands pack over the last few years has stayed pretty centralized in the Sabi sands. So they've been in kind of the Singita, Londolozi area, moved around the center portions. But for them, coming up into this part is very, very seldom. They don't generally come very far north into Buffleshoek and towards Manyeleti. And where we are right now, for them, is about a 10-minute run into the Manyeleti. So it's very, very, very far north. And I'm intrigued to see whether or not they turn and start going back southwest to where they normally hang around, or if there's a member of the pack that's joined that could be from a different pack and is now trying to drag them a little bit into areas that it knows. I don't know, but it's going to be super intriguing to see where it goes. Also, because the Pungwe pack is somehow kind of trailing behind them. The Pungwe pack was seen yesterday on Arethusa, and their general direction was following these guys on a very similar route that they took the morning before. And so it's going to be one of those things to see if the two packs eventually meet. If they do, there'll be quite a lot of competition between them, even though they're the same species. Packs don't really see eye to eye, and there can be a lot of chaos when two packs meet, particularly because both packs are quite large. You know, you're going to have over 30 wild dogs involved in an interaction, and it gets a little confusing, particularly for the smaller dogs, the little puppies. They get a bit confused with all the commotion, and you find dogs run in all directions, and it can be very dangerous for them because they chase each other. They don't pay attention to other things, and they run into the things like leopards and lions, and unfortunately then get themselves into a lot of trouble. So it will be interesting, should we say, a few weeks with both packs kind of being in a very similar area to whether they find each other. They also pick each other's scent up. I mean, these guys scent mark heavily when they run around. They defecate on roads, they roll around, they urinate. We know that this pack was calling yesterday morning, which the other dogs might have heard. So there's a lot going to happen between the two, I reckon, over the next little bit. As you can see, that dog is fast asleep. It's not in the mood to be doing too much just yet. Like I say, when you run around all day, the rest is deserved. Now, I have got zero comms, so I know that our directors are speaking to us, but I have no idea what they're saying to me at this stage. So we'll try and see if we can sort that out. You hear there's a Franklin that just alarm called, and that it meant that all the dogs popped their heads up.
The whole pack has just woken up when the pups started playing. So now they're running around greeting each other, playing with each other here in the gori tree. And so this is how they actually get each other excited for a hunt. And actually, looking at the rest of the pack, majority of them haven't eaten much. They definitely do need to hunt tonight. But all of this audio that you're getting, the sounds and that excitement and chasing each other, this is all to get ready for a hunt. They've calmed down again now that they've greeted each other. So what they might do is actually settle for a bit, bond a little bit, and then head straight out onto a hunt from there. It's unbelievable how quickly things changed. They went from completely flat to all of a sudden that chaos that I was expecting. And now they're going flat again. They've had a greet after sleeping apart for the day. And now they'll spend a little bit of time with each other before they head out. You can hear the thunder rolling in. Tinak, the easiest way to differentiate between male and female wild dogs is a combination of two things. So the first thing is you can look at the size. Male wild dogs are quite a bit bigger than females. And the second thing, which is the most obvious, is looking for genitals. So the males have very obvious testicles. They have a penile sheath that hangs down between their legs as well, off of their stomach. And the females, you'll see, have a much flatter stomach. They don't have the testicles. So if they lift their tails, you can actually see that they've got both entrances there. So they've got a vagina as well as an anus there. And so that's the easiest way to differentiate. Oftentimes, females as well, you can see their rows of teats hanging down or their nipples, where the males, you wouldn't see that. You'd see straight from the rib cage into the penile sheath. So those are the most obvious ways to tell the difference. Everybody looks nice and relaxed again. It's almost like they got a little second wind of energy and then went down for a second nap. The wind has actually picked up again. I wouldn't be surprised if they smell that hyena just now. Rachie, wild dogs would prefer any type of woodland habitat. So this is a woodland habitat. It means we've got quite a few shrubby trees. We've got some tall trees and the grass. So they can actually survive in pretty much any habitat that you can think of. You'll find them in Botswana, where there's the delta, so it's much flatter with lots of water. But their prime habitat is definitely any form of woodland. It doesn't have to be just low veld or bush veld like we have here. There are quite a few packs in KwaZulu-Natal where there is a more foresty type habitat. But this is actually their ultimate. There's actually a few vultures that we've seen coming in. I think they heard and saw that commotion. And so they're actually starting to circle above us. This is that old male I was talking about earlier as well. Have a look at the hooded vultures coming over. And then that very old male that is well past his prime. He's lost the tip of his tail. He used to be the alpha of this andBeyond Ngala pack. And he has since been overthrown by a younger male. So I would think he's at least 14 to 15 years old now, which is old for a wild dog. So I'm going to sit here and see what happens as they get more and more active. We're seeing a little bit of movement, and I'll send you over to Tristan with his very sleepy wild dogs.
As you can see, our dogs are not nearly as active as Tess's dogs up in Ngala. Ours are still very much asleep. There is a zebra that's not too far away that we're hoping is going to kind of come in this direction. That might trigger them to wake up and kind of chase that around. But honestly, I think these dogs are going to be sleeping until quite late this evening. They had a good meal this morning, so not only did they have that impala that they stole, we think that they stole from Insele, the female leopard, but they also potentially killed their own impala this morning too, which the guys saw them feeding and then kind of into the leopard sighting and feeding again. So they will have all had a fairly decent meal. We know that yesterday afternoon they also killed quite a lot. And so it seems like the pack is going to just have a easy kind of day of it and try and just enjoy the cool weather that they've got this afternoon. That's not to say if something doesn't come along that they won't take an opportunity. So if let's say hypothetically impalas move past them, I'm sure they would go after it. But for now, I think that it's just all about taking it very, very, very easy. The good thing is, though, is from where we are right now, there's a really nice big dam that they can go to. In fact, it's called Big Dam. And then there's also a big clearing where there's impalas. Stuck in bed, if what is, you're asking what would happen if wild dogs don't get along, do you mean within the pack? Because that's generally not going to happen. They're not going to become a fully fledged pack member unless they get along. They will, if there's a situation where they're trying to join a pack and they're not welcome, then they're going to be fought with and they can often be killed by that pack. So you'll even see within two packs kind of meeting that there sometimes can be issues and dogs can be killed. In fact, the Sands pack had a bit of a rough time earlier in the year when they came across the Investec pack and they were then attacked by them and a few dogs were lost through that attack. So it really is not always love between the dogs. If they come across, you know, other dogs can be aggressive. In terms of if they came across domestic dogs, they'd also be pretty aggressive to those too. At the end of the day, if it's not part of their pack, it's either a threat or it's food. And so that's how they pretty much treat everything that's away from them. And like I say, generally you'll find with these packs, what happens is that if there's a dispersal, that's when new packs are formed. Otherwise, members of dogs have to arrive at a pack and in a time when there's a high ratio of females, then males will arrive and they will be accepted if they're very submissive at first. Or if there's a high ratio of males within the pack and females arrive, often they're accepted in. So it really just depends on a number of different factors as to how kind of a dog is treated on arrival. That's for sure. Oh, there's one dog that looks like it's covered in mud. Have you been playing in the mud? Yes, looks like it. It's a little muddy wallow next to us here that looks like they've been playing in. So you'll see it just to the right. It looks like that mud has been churned up a bit. So I think some of the dogs have been lying in there, particularly the puppies, and that's why that dog is kind of looking more black than anything else. You are filthy. Your mother is going to be upset with you. Looks like trouble, that little one. Looks like it's starting trouble too. Cute though, either way. Wild dog puppies are very cute little things. I know a lot of people find dogs ugly, but I think that they, you know, their patterns and their coats and the fact that so many of them are different makes them very, very interesting. I mean, I don't know if I'd call them beautiful, but I'd call them interesting. They've got nice colorations on them. And it's kind of mesmerizing to look at in many respects with those big ears. I can't believe how spoiled we've been with dogs lately. I mean, we've had dogs at Ngala a lot. Now dogs here at Djuma also fairly frequently throughout this year, which is really good because in 2017, 18, 19, we had dogs, but it was not as frequent as we've had this year. We've certainly had a much better year with dogs, which is a treat. It's, you know, such an endangered animal, so to have them around a lot is always very, very special. But you can see how that wind is blowing at the moment. I expect that they're going to be very wary as it starts to get dark because of this wind and what could be lurking. All right, well, we'll stay with them. We're going to try and see what they get up to. Hopefully, they'll get moving at some stage.
WildEarth is launching our brand new Explorer program with an opportunity to win a very special WildEarth expedition. The lucky winner will get a behind-the-scenes WildEarth experience at the magnificent and beyond Ngala Tented Safari Camp. The prize includes a three-night stay for you and a friend with a chance to sleep out in the unique Ngala treehouse. Become a WildEarth Explorer and stand a chance to win this and many other prizes. Terms and conditions apply.
Oh, it's going to be in trouble now. Oh, this is unbelievable stuff. Here comes a hippo in too. Go, Impala! There's a hippo coming in. I can't believe what we're seeing here. This is what we'd normally see in East Africa. It's all over. Hippo leaping at the crocodile now. Everything's gone underwater.
Expect the unexpected here on WildEarth daily.
An ever-increasing part of the global population is losing its connection with nature. WildEarth is here to reduce people's stress and anxiety, allowing you to escape into nature even just for a few hours a day. However, WildEarth is expensive to run, and we need help from you to keep this ship going. WildEarth Explorers gives you the opportunity to be part of a program that supports the sharing of nature with the world.
Hi, I'm Kyle, and I come to you live every day here from Tswalu Kalahari in South Africa. My favorite bird has to be the social weaver. The enormous nest that they create, their survival tactics to inhabit these harsh and unforgiving environments, and as well as their complex social arrangements, is truly remarkable. And the interconnectedness with the ecosystem shows us that we are too.
Catch up with the guides daily here on WildEarth.
Well, as you can see, not much has changed, bar the fact that there's our muddy dog is clearly very uncomfortable. I suspect that this dog has got worms at the moment because it keeps standing up and rubbing its bottom all over the place. And it's often an indication of when they've got a few worms inside their gut, particularly tapeworm. You see them kind of rubbing and eventually these worms kind of get pulled out, and it eases the irritation, that's for sure. So he's kind of, I think it's a he, is up and down all over the place. But while it's kind of sitting in the grass, you know, often we portray that this is an easy thing to be out here and broadcasting from the wilds of Africa, but sometimes we have to get quite creative in order to be able to send you pictures as well as hear you. So as you can see now, I'm having to wear my radio on my hat so that I can hear everybody, because for some reason the radio, when it's lowered down, is not picking up the comms at all. But if I wear it on my hat like this, then we get a perfect signal. So that is some of the challenges that we have to do in order to be able to bring this to you guys in Africa. It's amazing that it actually does work. You'd think that the 30 centimeter difference between the car and my hat would not make a difference, but it does. It makes all the difference in the world. Little guy, are you really struggling? I don't know if maybe it's also got flies that are irritating it. It will be attracting a huge amount of flies being covered in mud. Anna Marie, you're right, it is an afternoon filled with wild dogs, but we had a morning filled with wild dogs yesterday afternoon, yesterday morning. It's been, you know, the last four drives have just been dogs all over the place. It's been quite wonderful, actually. They really are an amazing animal, because from a viewing purpose, they're an animal that excites people. It's generally high octane stuff when you're around wild dogs. They typically always up to something. So even now when they're sleeping, you know, you've got this one dog that is busy and is, I don't know, for some reason trying to figure out how to stop the irritations that are driving it mad at this stage. And so, you know, it's an animal that really does kind of get people excited when people see them, and, you know, chasing after them when they're hunting, or the interactions that they have with other predators like hyenas and leopards. These things really make for great game viewing, and so they're firmly kind of popular species for those that have been on safari multiple times, because most people don't really know about wild dogs or don't really care too much, because they're not these sort of part of the big five and they're not really regal and impressive to some. People see them and they're like, oh well, it's just, you know, kind of a mangy dog. But once they spend time with them and they start to understand the social dynamics, the way these animals move, the way that they hunt, the way that they fulfill their niche within an ecosystem, people generally come away with really enjoying wild dogs, and loving the experience of viewing wild dogs. Like I say, it is traumatic at times when they grab animals and pull them apart. I mean, that side of it is brutal, but there is obviously the softer side of them, which is this pack cohesion and the playfulness of the pups with the adults, particularly when, you know, they get going on a hunt or when they are lying up like this. And so they really do help their own species when people are able to actually see them in real life. I find that you show pictures of dogs to people and they're just like, ah, dog. But if they actually spend time with them, they're an animal that most people walk away with an appreciation for, and enjoy the kind of experience that they had with them. And that's vitally important because obviously these guys are under huge amounts of pressure at the moment. They're not an animal whose numbers have been growing throughout Africa. Their numbers are declining, except for this Kruger population. So over the course of the last 12 years, the Kruger population has started to increase. It started out at about 220 wild dogs about 12 years ago. And they reckon now they're edging up closer towards 400. So it's when you think about it, it's almost double the population. The problem with that now is that they've got a huge amount of issues with the dogs moving outside of the reserves because of the pressure and the growth of the population. A lot of the dogs are moving kind of westwards, and that's causing a few issues with the farmers and various other parties that are on those western boundaries. All right, we'll stay with the dogs. I'm sure they will get active at some point. In the meantime, we're going to send you across to Kim.
So we came looking for some cheetah, and Busani has found a cheetah mother and her subadult cub. And shame, this little duo has had quite a tough couple of days. I think a few viewers will remember from a couple of days ago, this mother lost her other cub, which was a male, young male. The brother of this young female that you see lying down flat in front of the mother. So they've had quite a traumatizing couple of days. There we go, the little one's head up. But it's good to see that they are happy and healthy, keeping alert, making sure that there aren't any dangers around them. You can see that they're in a nice open area, and anything that does come into this area, they'll see in time, giving themselves enough time to run away if they need to, or if it's going to be and then it'll roll over. So they'll often roll over like that so that they can keep all directions covered. They'll watch one way for a little while and then roll over on their back like that and watch the other direction for a little while. And they'll also often be facing different directions. As you can see, they're both facing different directions now, and that's also just kind of spreading the duties out so that all directions are covered. Shame. It's such a difficult thing in the wild to raise cubs to adulthood. This cheetah female actually started off with a litter of four cheetah cubs, and obviously as of very recently she's now down to only one. So let's hope that she gets this one at least all the way to independence, because yeah, this is a little female, so she'll eventually go off by herself. Female cheetahs are independent. They don't go around together, unlike male cheetahs. If there is a male cheetah or more than one male cheetah in a litter, then they'll form a coalition or a brotherhood and stick together through adulthood. Dom, there's not much time for mourning in the wild. You kind of just have to get up and get on with surviving. If these cheetah were to go around being sad, I suppose, or mourning, it wouldn't really be much use to them in terms of survival. Mourning's not going to help them get anywhere. So not long, I would say. She, I think, stuck around the area where the cub was taken, and she tried to call for it, and she was hoping that it maybe got away. And where we are now is actually not very far away from where the cub was taken. So she probably would have stuck around that area for a couple of days, calling, and just hoping that the cub might have gotten away. But that's as much time as she'll kind of spend on it. And once she's realized that it's not coming back, she'll just have to get on with life and concentrate on making sure that last remaining cub makes it to adulthood. Yeah, shame. I mean, what a life. No time for mourning, just survival only.
But you can see they're very well aware, and you can see the little cub as well. She's learned well from her mum, and she's got her head up and ears flicking, and she's on the lookout all the time. Shame. It is quite sad to say, but Glenn and I were just talking about how, you know, of the three of them, the one, you know, to go being the male is probably the best case scenario for one losing a life, because female cheetah, as we know that the cheetahs are pretty endangered, and female cheetahs are very important with keeping the population going, for obvious reasons. But so at least now we'll have another female coming to breeding age in another year or so, and then obviously this mother will hopefully be able to have another go at raising a litter. Maybe she'll be a little bit more successful next time, hopefully, if she learns a bit from this most recent litter. Ayana, cheetah have probably one of the lower lifespans of the cat family, and that's just because they are quite vulnerable. They're on the kind of lower side of the food chain when it comes to the cats. They're not as strong as the leopard and the lion, and so they generally can live to, well, they'll sometimes live to maybe 9 years old, but they can make it to up about 12 years old. But they do, I think, struggle a little bit more for survival than some of the bigger cats. Lions don't have many threats, and even leopards don't seem to have many natural threats, except for things like lions. But cheetah, yeah, they have quite a few animals after them, so they find it a bit more difficult to survive. They also have a bit more of a specific kind of habitat. So with habitat loss, that's also obviously something that's strangling their numbers a bit compared to the leopards and the lions. Quite an interesting place for them to actually have settled as well. I assume that they won't be doing any hunting in this area, because as we were driving in here, well, we're actually in kind of a dry riverbed, and there are lots of bumps and holes that makes this area quite treacherous for hunting cheetah. As we know, they've got very, very long, slender legs for speed, but that also makes their legs quite weak. So for them to run through an area that is very holy like this one, it can be quite dangerous. It's, again, I mean, in the wild, if a cheetah breaks its ankle quite badly, that could be a fatal injury, just in that it will then not be able to hunt and could actually starve to death. So hunting in an area like this would be quite dangerous, I think, for cheetah. I'm not sure it's a very clever spot to choose to hunt, but I think at the moment she doesn't look very, very skinny. She's got a little bit of a bulge to the belly, so she obviously has eaten in the last couple of days. I think that's probably not on the agenda for now. Just resting and keeping in an area where they feel safe and, like I said before, can see all around them. I think we are going to stick with these cheetah. We're going to see if they move around a little bit, but we'll head, let you move over to another live location.
OK, Can you hear the rain? This plum dung beetle can hear the rain. It is alive. It's playing with me at the moment. It's been walking all over. And then when I decided to put it on the dash so I can show it to you, it says, no, I'm tucking everything away. But that's okay, because I wanted to show you the reveal when they untuck and the little antennae come out. It's gorgeous. I've got a lovely sheen as well. Plum dung beetles are really common around here. See them all over. And when it decides to show us its front legs, you'll see how the comb-like structure of it helps it to pull dung. Are you going to show us? I think that was a firm no. Come on. No. Well, it seems like the storm is coming for us. You can hear thunder. No lightning just yet. So we can still be out and about. The temperature's dropped, which is quite nice. Remember when we started driving, it was 30 degrees Celsius. There's beautiful columns of rain in front of us. Just all the way. Look at those. Can you see that streaks? So cool. Look at those streaks of water coming down from the sky. That's like a curtain of rain. I think we still have some time before it really, really buckets down. And of course we need that. I'd love for that to happen. And now a little dung beetle. It's not, oh, bit of movement. Nope. Nothing, just raindrops falling on its exoskeleton. Oh well, I tried. I was hoping it would unravel for us, but not. So we're gonna move on. See what other little creatures we'll find now that it's become so much cooler.
Welcome back to andBeyond Ngala. The wild dogs are starting to wake up slowly, and that's because we also have some big rain coming. So if you have a listen, you might actually hear the thunder coming in. It's coming quite fast at the moment. The storm is definitely picking up here. The wind is starting to blow quite hard. And I think the wild dogs are going to be preparing to find some shelter soon, because the storm that is coming looks huge. Very exciting for us here. So I'm going to stick around and hopefully we get to see it rolling in.
So we're still sitting with these cheetah, not much has changed.
And see Mum's just having a nice rest there. She's got her eyes closed, but still ever alert, with her head up on her shoulder and ears twitching. Little female's put her head right down and having a good sleep. But yeah, I think that they probably won't move around too much. I was hoping for maybe a little bit of movement, but as I said earlier, you can see that they have eaten quite recently, so there won't be too much reason for them to get up and move around too much. There are some beautiful noises here though. There's some a gorgeous bush like I just heard calling. But Mum, the mother, is quite oblivious to all of the noises. You can see actually on her belly, like just in front of her hind leg, there's a kind of some ruffled fur and a little bit of blood. And I think what's happened there is that she's obviously just like a cat or a dog would when they're quite itchy, you know how they like nibble at this at their skin. I think she might have maybe nibbled at a tick and it's burst on her fur there, and I think that's what we're seeing there. Quite gross, but anyway, here we have it. I think that we are going to move on from these cheetah. I don't think they're going to move around too much. We'll send you over to Taylor, who has got a lion for you.
Now you can hear she's been spotted. So everyone is shouting at her now. Yeah, I can't. I don't know what they're saying.
No, I took them on.
Okay, welcome back. Sorry about that. You see Mum's now put her head down, which is relatively unusual for cheetah. As we always talk about, they've always got their heads up and they're always alert, but you can see that maybe the young cub has taken up the duty of lookout for the moment. I think these two have had quite an eventful couple of days, hunting and the loss of a brother, and even that kind of looking and searching for a member of the family can take up quite a lot of energy. It's like searching and calling and walking around a certain area, the area where that cub went missing. But even so, there she is up again, and she's never down for long. Okay, so we are again going to try and send you to Taylor and her lions, and we are going to go and see if we can find something else.
Well, it's been a pretty epic afternoon, obviously spending much time with the warthogs and the piglets, and now we've found a lioness by the name of Lagatha. However, I don't know how long we're going to be able to stay in the sighting, because we are about to be drenched. There is an enormous storm cloud on the way. We've been actually been trying to avoid it, but when we heard that she was sighted, we couldn't resist. But as you can see, I just want to point out, where is my hand? It's red. Rain. I reckon we've only got 2 minutes, 3 minutes before we're going to have to unfortunately make a race back to base, as we don't have a roof on this vehicle or much way to protect our equipment. But we'll have a quick look at her. It's of course going to be very important for Lagatha, the lioness of Leopard Dam, because when big rains come, that means it brings the wind.
and she will hopefully be able to hunt something. She doesn't look like she's eaten for some time, and so I think that's why she's skulking about, knowing that, of course, the water draws in lots of impala. There's big herds of impala that lurk around Leopard Dam. I can hear one snorting in the distance, so that's fine. If it does start raining, which it is right now, it's going to give her a really, really good chance of successfully catching something. And when you live on your own like this, it is very important to take every opportunity of any meal. And even if it's a small one, it's a best one. But unfortunately, we're going to have to race away from the rain now. But it was nice to have a quick look at Lagatha. Off you go to Tim, who's got an animal that might do some racing too.
So the wild dogs here at andBeyond Ngala have gotten up. They're now greeting and grooming each other on the road, and they look like they're about to start running towards our eastern boundary. So I definitely think it's starting to become the time for them to start hunting. A lot of them have very empty bellies. So it's very special to see such a large pack of wild dogs all together like this and moving. It's not something you'll get to see very often. These animals are up in Mobile East on South River Road. They look like they're thinking in formation, so those are all of the adults that have formed a bit of a wall at the front. These are the pups still on the road, greeting each other. They look like they're having a bit of a play session with a few on the ground, one on its back. And so the adults will actually decide, all right, it's time to go. As soon as they've started moving like that, you can see them trotting. And not long after, the pups will start following. Pups are having quite a good time. I think they really enjoy the sandy road. It's quite fun for them to roll in. There you can see the adults starting to run off. Right, as soon as those pups get moving, I'm actually going to follow them down the road. They are going straight towards our eastern boundary. Bob, yes, technically speaking, wild dogs are nomadic. They do hold a home range in the breeding season, which can be as large as about 450 square kilometers, which is huge. So they can move around quite a lot being nomadic outside of the breeding season. They will defend their home range, though, as though it were a territory. But they have been known to move quite far out of that territory, out of breeding season, out of that home range. So if they keep going this way, oh, the rain's coming, I can feel the rain. If they keep going this way, they're actually going to cross out of our eastern boundary fairly soon. So I'm hoping that before then they decide to hunt. And there were actually some impala down that way when we were coming over. There are quite big raindrops coming down at the moment, so I think that's exactly what got these wild dogs moving. They could feel that rain coming. It all of a sudden cooled down a lot. So now they've started moving in the hopes that this rain will help them hunt and keep their energy up as well. But it's actually incredible to see how they all almost seem to run in sync. High and wild dogs, when they're hunting, will kill their prey by all biting on at a different place and ripping it apart. It's actually the quickest of all of the kills of all of the different species. And it usually takes a few minutes from start to finish, from actually locking their teeth into the prey to actually having finished feeding on it. where it could take up to half an hour with some of the cats, especially lions, if they're hunting buffalo. We've had a kill here that lasted an hour and a half of the lioness trying to strangle and suffocate the buffalo cow while the other lions were already feeding. So in terms of kills, the wild dogs are the quickest and the most successful. These animals are temporarily static on South River, but general direction east. South River for now. Right, so I'm just chatting to the other rangers. They are wanting to come and have a look as well, so I'm keeping them updated, especially since the wild dogs are moving towards the boundary. I want to make sure that they all get a chance to see them as well. The rain is getting consistently harder, so it'll be interesting to see how long we can stay with them with this rain. One playing in the long grass here on the right. You can just see ears sticking out and the grass moving. That's actually one of the pups. They must be smelling something in the grass. Can you hear the rain? It's beautiful. It's nice and soft for now. It's big droplets, but it's soft rain, which is good because it means it's going to seep in. It's not going to wash things away. If it's too strong of a downpour, that's what would happen. Right, the rain is getting quite hard now. We might have to start covering up our equipment sometime soon. But I'm going to stick with them for as long as I can. I'm going to stay with them, see how far they go on this boundary road. Hopefully I can get some of the other rangers in here before it rains too much, and I'll send you over to Kim at andBeyond Phinda.
Okay, so I think you are left with just us this afternoon because it is raining everywhere else. I have to say that there are some doom and gloom clouds above us too, but hopefully we will not be rained off. We've come down to the floodplain just to look for some plains game. I saw a black-bellied bustard here earlier, which is quite similar to the red-crested koran, which I think Tessa showed you earlier this afternoon. So if we can find that again, might be nice for a bit of a comparison. And there was some other quite cool bird life. So that is what we're after down here on the floodplain. A herd of wildebeest ahead of us. Okay, so here we have a herd of wildebeest. Oh, with the lowly Ngala bull in the background. Or two. So this will be a group of females and youngsters. And most of these female wildebeest will actually be pregnant at the moment. I have not yet seen a wildebeest calf, which is quite exciting, so that's still to come for the season. Some of the babies will be dropping soon. Let's see who we can see that's got a nice belly. Oh, there we go. The one on the, so second from the right, she's got quite a big fat belly. You can see that really, really round sides. And if she flicks her tail, you might be able to see her udder is slightly swollen.
Sarah, so animals tend to find water by following valley systems, drainage systems, going to low-lying areas where they assume water would be. Also, on reserves like Phinda, there are set watering holes where the animals, and the animals are just familiar with those. Lots of animals hold little territories and become very familiar with the layout of their territory, and therefore they actually just know where the bodies of water within their territories are or within their home range. So, yeah, I mean, for example, with this herd of wildebeest, they probably will stay in this area. This will be part of their home range, so they'll be familiar with all the bodies of water in this area, and then as a result of that, their calves will also know the area pretty intimately, because they will then obviously follow their mothers around, follow the herd around, and grow familiar with the area as well. Then it would, you know, the case would be if an animal needed to look for water in an area that it didn't know. So, for example, maybe let's talk about the male wildebeest. So there may be some of the youngsters might grow up, or some of the calves that are about to drop will be males, obviously, and they will eventually be kicked out of the herd, and then they will have to go and find their own territory. And that obviously will then be a area that they might not be so familiar with, and in that case they would have to go in search of water. And yeah, like I said earlier, low-lying areas, follow valley lines, dry riverbeds, and things like that. And obviously also where the vegetation is thicker and greener, that tends to be around water as well. I'm going to have to quickly check in my book what the gestation period is, because I can't remember. But it is quite long. What's interesting about the wild is that predators will always have quite short gestation periods, whereas the prey species, such as wildebeest and impala, they have very short, very long gestation periods, because they allow to allow their calves to be very well developed when they finally hit the earth, so that they can run away from predators pretty much straight away. But obviously with predators, they can't hunt when they are heavily pregnant, so it's important that they have a very short gestation period, give birth to relatively undeveloped young, so that they can keep hunting and providing for their young. But let's see here. Oh dear, it's not. Days. There we go. That is the gestation period of the wildebeest. 250 days. Yeah, I mean, it's pretty incredible. When these young are born, they can run almost as fast as the adults. Pretty, like, half an hour after they're born. You watch these little things pop out, and they are so wobbly on their feet, on their legs. They wobble around, they struggle to stand up, they stand up and they fall over again, and it's like, it's such a desperate thing to watch, because you're like, oh, come on, just stand up. But it takes quite a while. But when they get up and they have their first drink, it's so quick for them to just start running around and leaping around with such energy. You know, you can't believe that the same animal that you're seeing prancing around the place is the one that you've just seen falling all over the place. So, you know, it's pretty amazing compared to the predators, where you won't see
young predators very often, because for the first 3 months of their lives they are kept in hiding places because of their vulnerability, because they're so underdeveloped they have to be kept hidden. But if any of you have ever had a dog or a cat who has had a litter of puppies or kittens, you'll know that those little things are so vulnerable. They are partially blind, they squirm about the place, their little legs don't even work, they crawl around on their bellies. I mean, they are so, so vulnerable. And it's just, yeah, it's amazing how nature just kind of sorts itself out in that way. It balances itself out. A number of them have just put their heads up. Oh, there's two more wildebeest running across in the distance. Alex, I do not know the answer to that question. I don't know how long wildebeest can go for without drinking water, unfortunately. They are relatively water dependent. Sorry, it's quite interesting what's going on here, though. There's two males are running across in the distance, and the male that was with this group that we've been watching has just gone charging off after them. And he's kind of bellowing at them. Oh, and there's a fourth one coming in from the other side as well. It's quite funny. As you can see, there's not really any actual blows happening. They're all kind of just running at and towards and around each other in a kind of aggressive running dance. Interesting that this one here who is with this group feels the need to assert his authority, because breeding season is over. As we were talking about, all these females are pregnant, so there's no mating going on at the moment. But yeah, the males will feel the need to look after the herd that they're currently belonging to. Although with wildebeest, they don't tend to have a set kind of male leader. The females tend to actually move from one male to the next. Male wildebeest have very small little territories, and as you can see, I mean, as we just saw, there were about four males chasing one another in quite a small area, and they'll all have a very small little territory each that they hold. And in breeding season, the females will move through these territories, and they'll actually mate with quite a number of the different males, and he'll try and cover as many females as possible. So the youngsters that'll be given birth to will be quite genetically varied because of that, moving from one male to the next. And the males will try and stay with the group, and they'll move into the next male's territory, and then they'll get shoved out as that male, you know, realizes that there's another male in his territory. I think we're going to carry, I'm just going to carry on going. I'm going to move round to where the other group of wildebeest are, and I can also see some zebra around there. Going to go nice and slowly past this group. We don't want to alert anyone or disturb them. Year is quite cool, or this time of year is really, really cool, seeing all the little babies. So we've already had most of the impalas have dropped their lambs. Have seen a few
pregnant or still pregnant impalas, but most of the herds of impalas now have little groups of babies, which are so cute. And the warthogs should also be giving birth soon. I have to say, I think that the piglets are my favorite babies in the bush. They just, yeah, I don't know what it is about them. They're so cute. Jay's asking what my favorite animal interaction is, and I think that's quite a difficult question because there's so many animals and like animal interactions between different species obviously happen like kind of few and far between, but like now just speaking and thinking about it, I would say some of the more interesting ones I've seen are probably between lion and rhino. And the reason I say that is just because I think that they don't quite know who is above the other in terms of on the food chain. Like with elephants and rhinos, elephants know that you know, the rhino is below them on the food chain, whereas, and they'll move out of the way for them. Cheetah know that they're below a lion, so they'll move out of the way for a lion, but rhino and lions kind of don't seem to know where they stand with one another. So there's often a bit of a face-off, like, are you going to be scared? Am I going to be scared? So that's always quite an interesting one. But we've got some zebra over here, and there's actually quite a sweet little baby zebra, talking about babies. Couple of baby zebras and a couple of pregnant zebras also. So zebras, unlike wildebeest and impala, they aren't so tied to the seasonal breeding. They do tend to kind of, you'll see that there'll be more zebra foals around this kind of time of year, and that's just because of timing. Zebras, like the rest of the seasonal breeders, can time their breeding so that it's they drop their foals in the rainy season, which is now. But it isn't so set in stone. You can see foals throughout the year. But you won't see impala lambs, and you won't see warthog piglets, and you won't see wildebeest calves throughout the year. They are exclusively seasonal breeders. KP's giving me another gestation period question, and I'm going to have to look it up again because I've been useless and have forgotten everything over my leave. The gestation period of a zebra is 375 days, so about a year. So that's quite interesting. I mean, they're kind of breeding at or mating and dropping of foals will all kind of be happening at the same time if they were seasonal. So I think that we are going to probably carry on looking around this floodplain to see if we can see any more bird life, seeing as that's what we came here for. But I think Trishala is back with us, so we're going to send you over to her for now.
Ooh, bird life. That's something we're not going to see too much of in this rain. My face is getting a very good moisturizing. At least it's not cold, but the rain is falling hard.
And at least there's no lightning for now, so we can try our best to stay out. And I'm heading at the moment to the den, because it's always nice to have a static sighting in weather like this. Instead of one where you have to drive around, because then everything gets soaking wet. So some of the best times in Djuma, when it rains like this. I remember last year, the dams just filled up almost overnight. It was insane. We couldn't drive the next day or the next few days because the roads were all closed and the bush just got the most magnificent watering ever. Hello, Impalas. Let's spend some time looking at you in the rain. Oh, listen to that rain. Scott and Red Bull Ox pick a friend. Kukama, you'd like to know how many predators are in this area. Of the big predators, lions, leopards, cheetah, but not as often as you would see in, say, Phinda or Tswalu. Although we do get them, especially in the north, where it's a little bit more open. And then, of course, wild dogs, hyenas, wildcat. And those are just the big ones. There's also small, little predators. There's civets and gurnets and even the occasional serval. Lots and lots of predators, and that's not even to mention aerial predators or reptilian predators. Crocodiles, we get crocodiles. Predators on all levels, even insect predators. Dragonflies, for example. At least our impala don't have to worry about the dragonflies or the aerial predators. For them, they've just got to watch out for lions, leopards. What a short list you have to watch out for, impalas. Lions, leopards, cheetah, wild dogs, hyenas. Poor things really do catch it in the bush. Rona, you'd like to know, how do impalas protect their lambs from predators? A good question, but I think a better question is, how do they protect their species and the continuation of their species from predators? Because not every individual lamb matters. It's the fact that enough lambs grow up to a maturity to reproduce. So when you talk about just a singular individual, the only way lambs are protected, in the first few weeks, they lie up very, very low in dense bush and they will not move. For a lamb to come out into the open, something would have to be wrong. The mother would have not come to see it for a long time, or something like that. Also, lambs can move pretty quickly, very nimble, and the herd protects them. In that, in a herd, as long as there's somebody behind you, you're pretty much safe. So the whole way that a herd develops is that one creature wants another behind it, and another one behind it, and another one behind it, and all of a sudden you've got a herd. And everyone trying to run away means that the majority of the herd can survive if one of the ill or ones in the tail end get eaten. But those are little things, because at the end of the day, the impala ewe and the rams, which are reproductive age individuals, would much rather survive than a lamb, because they can always reproduce. And that's important, because Everything out here needs to make sure that the species progresses and makes it to the next generation. And that's why I said a better question is, how does the species survive? How do enough lambs survive to become the next generation of reproducing animals? And they do that by making sure that they flood or saturate the bush with lambs so that if predators take them, there's only so many they can take. Remember, there are far fewer predators than there are herbivores or prey species. And just by sheer saturation, at least half of the lambs are surviving. And that's why you see so many of them all around. Really, many of them are as a sacrifice so that others can make it. It's an interesting idea, and this is one that we know very well. Predators can only, there are only so many predators, and they can only take so many impala lambs and only eat so much. Sorry about that, impala. You looked at me. Ashley, you'd like to know what the difference between impala and springbok are? There are a couple differences. Firstly, they're completely different genuses, but they are. Sorry, I'm just emptying some water that has collected on me. But they are both even-toed ungulates. But they're completely different genuses, even though they look very similar. Springboks, both the females and males, have horns. The impalas, only males have horns. And they also have, oh, look at that shake, so much water. They also have a very particular markings on their faces, springboks. And they will pronk while impalas will stot. So pronking is when they raise the back hairs on their neck up and they kind of put both limbs facing downwards quite straight, so it looks like they're jumping on a trampoline. Springboks do that, and impalas don't do that. What they do is they will jump and kick their hind legs up. So this is just a couple of the differences between a springbok and impala. But I am going to now move towards the hyena den, which is just around the corner of those impala, and I'm going to send you over to Kim, I think. Not sure actually, because I didn't quite hear that, but have fun.
I hope you can see. Oh yeah, we've got our two little birds over here, and they are Temex coursers. They are actually nocturnal birds. They've got quite big eyes, and they somewhat resemble lapwings, or the old name would have been plovers. But you can see they've got some pretty interesting movements there. Stop, does a little bum movement, and then head down and trots off through the grass, trying to keep hidden. When we first came across them, he was quite chilled. It was right next to the car, and then as soon as we decided we wanted to show them to you, decided to run as far and fast as he could. But he's beautiful, so he's got that. I think I'm going to try and turn around, see if we can get a better view. Yeah. Oops. They really do have beautiful markings, though. They've got this kind of stark, dark, or black line across their eye that meets at the back of their head in the kind of V. Oh, there's three of them, actually. You got them. Okay, so see this little bush right here? There's two on the left and one on the right. Yeah, I think what we're seeing, I think we've got two adults closest to us. and then a youngster further away. Yes, Les, they are very cute, and I actually really enjoy their movement, like how they run along and then stop and they do that like bum wag where they kind of like lower themselves to the ground, maybe peck a few times, and then they sprint off again with their head quite low. They really are cute. And they also look quite like they've got some swag with their eye stripe. They look like they've got sunglasses with, I don't know, like sunglasses straps holding them on around the back of their heads. Oh, flying off. Oh, I see what's chased them. There is, it's chasing them still. It's a wattled lapwing that's just landed to the right of the road, and it was actually chasing them off. And that's just rude, because those little birds pose absolutely no threat to that lapwing. So why he would be chasing them, I do not know.
Still on the lapwing, I've kind of lost vision.
Yeah.
I
can't see the coursers anymore. I can only see the lapwing. So he made right his chase and sent that little family of Temex coursers running. Shame. He's even coming back now. CJ, yes, birds can be territorial. So like what we've just seen here, this lapwing possibly has a nest or maybe a baby, and he is just protecting the area around that nest, which would be his territory. But yes, birds can definitely be territorial. There are a number of birds of prey that also have territories. They have a nest that they'll use year after year in breeding season, and the area surrounding that nest is their territory. So yes, answer is yes, they do have territories. Oh, it's so good to be back. This is such a beautiful scene here with all the zebra and the wildebeest, our birds, just this beautiful open area. There's some fever trees in the background. It's just really, really good to be back. Feeling all like invigorated being out here. Stephanie, that's a good question. I grew up actually going to Kariba in Zimbabwe. So my knowledge of the bush was actually not like this. It wasn't going on game drives and viewing animals up close. It was actually going fishing early in the morning and just seeing what you could from the water. So hippos, I knew quite a bit of. Crocodiles, loads of them. And then every now and again, if you were lucky, you'd see like some buffalo on the side, maybe some elephant. And I just loved it. I found it fascinating, and I've always loved nature. I've always just wanted to be outside. And I loved birding from a young age. My dad and my grandfather are both good birders and brought me into it at a young age. And yeah, I've just always loved being outdoors, and at one point I thought, wow, I can actually make a career out of this. And here I am. I guess that's kind of the story. I did try a few other jobs first and then decided that this was definitely better suited to me. And every time I come back to it, it's confirmed like how yeah, what a good decision it was, to be honest. Thanks, Stephanie, just reminding me why I'm so happy to be here.
I think that as beautiful as the scene is, we're going to leave it. It is starting to get a little bit dark, and I think that we should move our focus onto some of the nocturnal animals. I'm going to turn us around and I'm going to head us into a habitat where we may come across some leopards, or hopefully find a leopard. But for now, while we do that, I'm going to send you back to Trishala.
Have you been watching Wild Earth and dreamt of being right there on safari with one of the guides? Well, now you can. Wild Earth is offering you a chance to buy a ticket to dream. You or a friend can hop on board a live Wild Earth show and join our guide on safari. The ticket is redeemable at any of our locations anytime in the future. Only a limited number of tickets are available, so don't wait. Get your ticket now and start dreaming. Terms and conditions apply.
My name is Ross, and I'm a field guide at andBeyond Phinda Private Game Reserve. I love getting questions from guests on Wild Earth because I love sharing and learning information about nature with new people, and it also makes me feel like you're all joining me in real life. If you want to ask a question on Wild Earth, then you need to register on our website. Once registered, go to our live safari page and submit your question below our live feed.
Welcome to my car. This is Wendy, and she's my favorite. She would love to have your name attached to her, so you can be with her every single time she goes on a safari here in Djuma. If you become a Wild Earth Explorer, you will have the opportunity to buy an engraved tag, which we will attach to her. We will make sure to send you a digital picture to show you exactly where you are sitting on her. You will have front row seat in every single sighting.
Hello, boy.
You are a monster. And he's coming right up to us. Hello, boy.
Oh, settle down. Settle down. He is very, very close. He's pushing his trunk against the car. You can feel the car moving.
Hey. Stop that.
Expect the unexpected here on Wild Earth daily.
Okay, so we found another bird. It is a collared pattern call. I'm glad that I've just previously described to you that I love birding. But so he's just next to us here. I'm going to try and direct Glenn towards him. But so if you can see, so this first patch of grass. And then there's the second kind of little patch in between those.
Between, is he in there?
Yeah, he's there.
Is he sitting down?
Yeah. That's like, yeah, he's in the mud part. Go. Oh, yeah, there it is. Yeah, in the middle. There we go. We got him. There he is. Oh, he's so beautiful. Yeah, so camouflaged against doing a little head bob, and he's making a bit of noise as well. So you can see quite clearly that dark collar around or under his chin, and that's what gives him the name of the collared pattern call. Really beautiful markings and that little hooked bull. And there he goes, run. Oh, it looks like he caught something. Such an interesting little head bob. We've seen quite cool little animal bird movements. I mean, we've seen the courser doing its thing. And I've just heard a black-bellied buster doing its champagne popping noise. Just looking around for him now. I can't actually see where that noise came from. So we've got the pattern call doing its head bob, the courser doing its kind of bum dip, and then the black-bellied bustard doing its
champagne cork popping. David, this bird, I do not know. I shall tell you, though, whether or not it is monogamous. Oh, and off he goes. Yes, they are monogamous. So his partner would probably be around here somewhere. He might have been calling to him. But like I said earlier, I'm going to carry on with our plan. I'm going to take us into a nice thick area. As you can see ahead of us, it's starting to thickening up. So we are going to carry on our search for a leopard, but for now I will send you over to Dushala and her snail.
I would also like to search for a leopard because we heard some alarm calls, or some alarm calls were heard, rather, not by me, near Vuyatela Dam. So we'd like to go and check that out. But here we have the quintessential rainy day creature, a giant African land snail that is very tiny at the moment. It's only about, I'd say, maybe 7 centimeters. Tiny little guy and gal, as we've learned this morning. Slowly making its way across the road. So many years ahead of it. These guys can live from 5 to 10 years. It's a long time for a little snail. Look how little it is. That's a long road ahead of you. So cute. We had such a privileged sighting this morning to see the giant African land snails exchanging gametes or mating. And something that we don't get to see often. Jessica, you'd like to know, what do snails eat? They're what we call detritivores. So they eat detritus. Basically, decaying matter, organic matter. Oh, that's their preference, but they'll go after any vegetation. Occasionally even carrion. And they will sometimes eat mushrooms. That's why for me they're an extra fairy tale creature. Can you imagine one chomping on a mushroom? Not on a toadstool, though, because those are horribly, horribly poisonous. They move so slowly, and I sometimes just wonder what the world must look like for them. Strangely, there is some work has been done on the perception of time for different animals. And little things like, for kids it seems that the day goes so much longer and things take so much longer. And then when you're an adult it seems that time passes so quickly. And a couple studies and a lot of research was done into the amount of information an animal processes at a time. And when an animal is moving very, very quickly, or they're kind of hyper, then time moves very fast for them. because they're taking in almost a lot of frames per second. And information around them is changing so quickly. So it's thought that smaller animals and animals that are fast moving experience time much more quickly than large animals. Oh, so you got it the wrong way around. A lot more slowly because they're processing, they're taking so much in at one time. So it's as if they've got to sift through a whole lot of things. So they're taking in a whole lot of frames. So time is going a lot more slowly. They've got to almost process all this information. But in a slow-moving animal, time is going quite quickly for them. Or a large animal, time is going quite quickly because they're taking in only few things per second or per moment. They're only processing limited amounts of information. So time goes very quickly because they're looking at one thing and then another thing and then another thing, and those things are processed kind of in due time. Whereas an animal that's moving very quickly has a lot to process and needs to process all of it. So it's kind of hyper, and now time is moving very slowly because it has all this work to do, almost. So for a land snail, I would imagine that time is moving quite quickly. Because before they know it, it's been one day, and all they've processed is this one strip of road or whatever. It's kind of a strange concept and a strange thing to wrap your head around, that you're smaller and moving quickly, so time goes slower. Whereas if you're moving slowly, time is going faster. It's strange and sometimes very difficult to wrap your head around. As you saw there, I got mixed up and I'm finding it difficult to wrap my head around that too. But a lot of research has gone into that, and I think it's really special because we don't know much about the way animals perceive things. We only know about the way we perceive things and the way we perceive animals to perceive things. That was my science rant for the day, everyone. I think the snail has pulled itself in now. John, you'd like to know, why do snails come out in the rain? That's because their bodies, which is the fleshy part, that fleshy bit is really delicate and prone to desiccation, which basically is a fancy biological word for dehydration. It can get dry. And if it gets dried out, then it would die. You might have seen slugs and snails in your yard that have gotten dried out and they're very, very hard. They are kind of like a wine gum. If you're South African, you'd know what I mean. Like a little wine gum, they look very, very difficult. And I've touched many a dead slug and snail in my life. And that means that all the moisture from their body is gone. So when it rains, there's plenty of moisture around in the air, on the ground, where they move through, and they can keep hydrated, which is very important, otherwise they'd die. Become very dark. Sassy Cassie, you'd like to know how many species of snails we have in South Africa? Oh, I have no idea. Plenty. There are some invasive species. There are lots of slugs. There are those yellow ones, those black ones. And and varieties of all of them. There's obviously giant African land snails. There's sea snails. Plenty, plenty, Sassy Cassie, and I do not know the number. Can you hear this wonderful rain? Loving it, just loving it. It's like the snail. Snail's loving it. Are you loving it while time passes so quickly for you? It's probably like, Shala, I have no idea what you're talking about. Time passes just fine for me. Jack, do you ask if the shell can break off the snail? Absolutely. But this particular snail has quite a hard shell and is very rich in heavy metals. So it's a more robust shell than others. But yes, it can very easily break. You could, and especially when they're young like this, you could probably break it in the palm of your hand by making a fist. A very strong person would be able to break a shell the size, I guess, of my fist in their hands. But it takes a lot of effort. But cars, for example, you often find these snails run over by cars. In fact, we saw one on Gari Main, which is our southern boundary. Snail whose shell was crushed, and speaks hinged tortoise busy having a go with the fleshy body. How awesome is this rain? I think we're gonna try to move ever so slowly. The quicker I get moving north, the better, because the rains are predominantly coming from the south, but they're kind of coming from the east, the west, or the northwest and the south at the same time. But if I start heading north, at least the wind that's moving from the south to the north will not carry the rain into my face. And we'll very carefully go over our snaily friend here. Thank you, Mr. Snail. Rainfall for Djuma is, it's about 400 to 600 millimeters. But it obviously depends on whether it's a year for drought or it's good rains, but obviously it's an average, so it means it's averaged out over a period, a long period. I'm just gonna cover everything, give me a moment. Well, let's just drive and enjoy whatever we see. I'm going to attempt to take my spotlight out without dropping too much water in the vehicle. Please let it not have gotten wet or too wet. Yay. All right. Well, chameleons are going to be difficult. Because they don't like it when it's rainy and cold. Maybe we'll be able to find some frogs. Or a leopard, and that would be awesome. That would be lovely. Oh, Kim! Kim has an elephant! That is beautiful. I think I'm going to look for an elephant and a leopard after you come back to me. But now you go to Kim and see her elephant.
So we have found an elephant and we're very excited about it. I didn't actually spot it. I was busy looking at a rhino on the opposite side of where we are sitting, which is a bit too far for us to see in with the camera. But Glenn spotted this elephant, which is embarrassingly close to the car for my not seeing it. But there it is. He's beautiful. And he is destroying that poor tree in front of him. But that's okay because he has to eat too.
And it looks like he's stripped pretty much all of the leaves off of that tree already. Oh no, he might even just take the whole thing out. No.
See how he's using his foot to kick up? Kind of had his trunk around a clump of grass and then he used his foot to kick it up so that the roots released it.
Actually looks like a bit of like a kind of bush that he's eating, they're not grass. It's just amazing how they can use that trunk so nimbly. I mean, see now how he's kind of sorting through that bush around that little trunk there. He's got his foot involved. Oh my gosh, it's just amazing.
Knew exactly what he wanted out of that little bush. Sniffed it out and used his trunk and foot to get it. Karen, my favorite thing about elephants. Wow, there's lots of things that I really enjoy about elephants. I mean, there's nothing better than that low tummy rumble that they give to communicate between one another. That's really something to witness. So that's something pretty amazing. I mean, watching them use their trunk like we're witnessing right now is also just so special. Like, look at the way he just moves from one bush to the next. Like, nope, I don't want that. Okay, I want that. He's so, I don't know what the word is, just like specific and he just knows exactly what he wants. There's no like kind of shuffling around. It's like, I don't know, you imagine, you know that game where your friends put something into a bag and then you have to put your hand into the bag and guess what it is. I mean, that's a pretty difficult game. I have no idea what, you know, you never know what you're touching. And they just like, I don't know, they just seem so sure of themselves with their trunks. And I think that's a really special and really impressive thing. And just the way they use kind of other parts of them with their trunk. So they sometimes will pull something over their tusk to break it off, and they'll use their feet. But yeah, they also just they seem so clever and understanding, and I'm sure that most people know that, or most of our viewers will know that elephants have a reputation of being extremely clever and having a really, really complex social structure between them and their herds.
So that's also, I guess, really, really special. But I think that that's also something that I can't favour of them, because it's something that I'm not a part of. They very much communicate with one another, and they have beautiful interactions with one another and relationships with one another. But we aren't involved in that, and we can just kind of watch it and observe it, and yeah, I guess just kind of not really understand it. Elephants are not territorial. They actually, they're actually quite migratory. So they can move really, really great distances. Elephants, before there were so many fences and fenced reserves and things like that, elephant herds would migrate hundreds and hundreds of kilometers, you know, cross countries, and often they would do those same routes over and over, but not necessarily territorial. And with that they'll often, or they can even be a number of herds mushed up together into one kind of super herd of elephants in their migrations, so they're not really territorial, no. But as you can see, I mean, I'm talking about herds and everything, but this bull is alone. Grace is asking me if elephants see well, and my answer to that would be yes, they do see well. Most animals in the bush see better than us, than people. I know that rhinos have a reputation of not being able to see very well, but I think that that's all relative. I think that they don't see very well in comparison to, say, impalas and maybe leopards and lions, but they still have very good eyesight, and it's probably par with ours, if not a little bit better. And I think elephants also have pretty good eyesight. They do have quite small eyes. I wonder if that's not why you asked the question, Grace, because for such a large animal, their eyes do seem quite small on those enormous heads of theirs. But yeah, I think that their kind of strongest sense would be their sense of smell. I think they can smell very, very well. And when I was talking earlier about how they're so sure of the things that they touch with their trunks, obviously us with our fingers we just feel, but they are touching and obviously also smelling whatever they touch with their trunks. So it is getting a little bit dark, and I would like to carry on with our leopard search. So we're going to leave this elephant to his browsing for the night and see what we can find.
You can hear the rain still. As I said, it was not as bad as I thought it would be. But we're just going to listen to it for a little while. I can still hear a woodland kingfisher. Thank you. Lovely sounds, but now we're going to head up to quarantine. Hopefully find a last-minute leopard.
We've actually decided to stay with this elephant. He's still munching away. But it is pretty cool to be able to just sit here with him. He's so unperturbed by us. He just doesn't mind at all that we here. Sharing his space, watching him go about his natural ways. I'm just going to move forward. Tanya, so as I was talking about elephant social structures earlier, they're very social animals. So obviously that doesn't seem like the case now with this single bull. But calves will actually stay with the herd, well, especially the cows, for life. Sorry, I thought I saw something off to the right. But I'm not actually sure when, at what age, but I think around about the age of like 10, the males will start to be pushed out of the herd. Maybe between 10 and 15, they'll start to be shoved out of the herd because they become quite boisterous as teenagers, and they start to put the younger calves in danger. So pretty much all the dynamics or social dynamics of an elephant herd are organized around looking after or keeping the calves safe. And they don't want these boisterous young elephant bulls making trouble and putting the youngsters in danger. So at that point, they'll send the young bulls out. And then they will become like what we see here, this bull here, these lone bulls. And when they come into must, they will then go and try and find the herds again and try and mate. But that'll only come a little bit later. Beautiful calls. You can hear the red-chested cuckoo calling quite loudly in the background. He'll sometimes go all night long. Sandile, elephants generally will sleep at night time, but you can see them kind of having rests even in the daytime as well. But generally they're not nocturnal, so nighttime is when they'll do most of their sleeping, and they'll lean up against a tree or an termite mound, but they do sometimes also lie down. But yeah, nighttime, so he will probably feed for a little while longer. And then he'll maybe go and try and find somewhere where he will sleep. That's possibly where he's heading off to now. He's just suddenly stopped and decided, okay, feeding is over. Oh, and he's just gone on to the next bush, and I'm very jealous of Trishala's leopard that I will now send you over to.
My leopard has just walked into a bush and not come out. It looked like Klalamba, but I couldn't get a good enough look.
There she is, there she is.
Last leopard winning. And try and have a look at her. She's gonna come up onto the road now. The best I can do. Now let's move forward just a little bit. There's our IR light. There's a follower for now. It looked like Klalamba. It's here by Tumbeta House, which is quite close to. It's just. Thing is, so our IR light is not working, but she is hunting and I don't really want to disturb her. So we are going to have to just hope that we get lucky with looking, being able to see her and being close enough to see her. I'll try, don't want to spotlight her. I'll try, see there's impala out to the side here. JP, you say last minute leopard, all right. Slinking away. Certainly last minute leopard. Last minute leopard troubles, but at least we got a last minute leopard. It is Klalamba. Did you go, girl? I'm sorry that the visuals are horrible, guys, but I'm sure you'll understand that I'd far rather us have horrible visuals than prevent her from getting a meal tonight. Girl, do you want to show yourself? Slinking away. She's gonna come out onto the road. Maybe we will be able to see her for the last few seconds. There we go. That's our last few seconds, guys, because that is my car lights and I don't want to do this to her. So, last view. Walking towards Tumbeta House, and that is it. Last minute leopard, hurrah! I'm so glad. I said to Marcel, let's go up to quarantine because I bet there's gonna be a last minute leopard there. Very, very happy about that. I'm glad that the rain didn't stop us at least from finding our precious Klalamba. At least I thought that was her. Gosh, when I looked at her, she looked at me in the eyes, I thought, stop, let me look at you properly. But I'm sure you would know if you get a screenshot. But thank you all for joining us on this rainy day and staying with us. And thank you for your questions and your comments, because we will see you tomorrow morning. Hopefully it won't be as rainy. And we'll see you for sunrise safari. So bye-bye for now.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you are excited.